Let's simply go for it.
Yeah. Okay, hi. Officially on
Hello.
The
on the good record. Morning, Svena Malia. Nice to see you today.
Nice to see
how
you.
Are you?
Hey, how are you?
Yes, I'm good.
You're well. And
yes.
You will be well. And
yes, by yeah. the grace.
Yes.
So let's go for today's
session.
Our subject, yes. Our session, you know, we are both inspired by Jakob Haefner, by what he left to us. And it's a wonderful subject to talk about with someone like you who has done your own research into the history of the dance in Tamil Nadu. So away.
Yeah. No, I think what fascinates me with Jakob Haefner is the fact that amidst all the voices that speak of the dance and the context within which dance existed and the dancers mm-hmm. themselves, his voice really stands apart.
Yeah.
Because he speaks of them very differently.
Yeah.
You know, it looks almost as if he's seen them through a very different lens.
Actually, I think in the whole context of his time, his voice stands out. Like, I mean, we hear about him like as an anti-colonialist, but in his time, that was the voice in the desert, huh? Because everybody was only about greed. The Westerners,
right?
That related to India. There were always other people who really related to India. But because of his circumstances, you know, he came back from India with quite a lot of money and he invested that in French government bonds. Mm-hmm. And in 1796, from one moment to the next, he lost all his wealth. Mm-hmm. So he got into really trouble financially. He was used to a lavish lifestyle and traveling. And from one moment to the next, he had to try and earn his money. And yeah, he was not, in a way, not very efficient in that respect. He had been completely trained for the Indian situation. He had gone to India as a child, as a young man. And he had evolved himself there into being a bookkeeper and a translator. And so then he got this idea to write books. So from 1800 till 1809 or 1808, when he died, he wrote 3 books. And then later, because he had been a diarist, he had been writing, keeping diaries for all his life. So later his son published 3 more books mm-hmm. based on the diaries. Now, I know that the writer, Paul van der Velde, he tried to trace these diaries and the drawings, because he made drawings also. Mm-hmm. He had, as a young man, he had been a student of a painter in Amsterdam. So he was he could draw. And on the basis of his drawings, they made these, these prints in his books. And they were bestsellers in his time. They mm-hmm. were bestsellers. And I think the first one was the travels to Sri Lanka, to Ceylon. Mm-hmm. And I don't know which were the 3. Yeah, that is sort of thing I forget. There were 3 books published. I think his early time in Coromandel, in Nagapattinam and Sadras, and then his flight to Sri Lanka, and then his time in Sri Lanka, and then travels by Palanquin. I think those were the 3 books that were published, and they were bestsellers. So he realized he could earn a living. And at the same time, there was this contest. It was a kind of, I don't know, typically 17th century, 18th century thing. I don't know. There was an amount of money given out by some local cultural organization here in Haarlem. And somebody had to write about the merits of colonialism, because the important thing about his lifetime is that the attitude of the people from the West who interacted with India changed. Mm. From the time that they first arrived there till about 1800, the attitude had been one of awe, of respect, of you know, of, you know, they would go, what I say, cap in hand, you know, they would go like this. This is the Indian way. And in the West, we say cap in hand, you know, they take off their cap and they would go to the rulers. If they could please, please, please have this small cottage on the coast for the trade. And of course, the Portuguese had a little bit different attitude because they were Catholic and they were kind of part of an empire. But the Dutch, they were from very simple background.
Mm.
And I know they misbehaved very badly when in what is now Indonesia. But in India, they came with respect. They came with fear. And so they would beg the kings for just a small cottage on the coast where they could do their trade. And from the money they made there, they built Amsterdam. That is our golden age. That is between 1600 and 1680. Amsterdam, that money was made, of course, also in Indonesia. And so you can see, even up to the 1830s, 1840s, when people, Western people, write about India, write about astronomy, write about the sciences, they write with respect. Mm-hmm. And that changed when India lost its sovereignty to the English, and it's a separate subject.
Yeah.
I don't even quite understand it, how such a great nation allowed this to happen, but victim blaming isn't going to solve it. So, and I don't want to do that at all, but this was a crucial moment in history for India and also for England and for the rest of the world, because India in a way lost its power to the English, and this whole English thing about Britain ruled the waves, it's, they only were able to do that because they fleeced India, because they bled it. And my guess is one of the reasons they left in 1948 was because there wasn't anything left and the country had to be invested in, because they had destroyed everything. They had destroyed the textile industry. They destroyed the steel industry. They destroyed everything they could destroy. They did because of a complex. And they left India with the inferiority complex, and they have the superiority complex. And it's, you know, for India, it's deeply sad, but you are regaining your ground. I mean, by their grace, and the Brits, I mean, they're leaving the European Union because they think they can do it on their own. And I think they're going to have a big shock. So, but that's a separate subject. Anyway, so Jacob Hafner wrote this piece, which has also not been translated yet, against the colonial, you know, and he did research. He researched South America. He researched the Portuguese. He researched Indonesia. And I haven't read it. I've read only about it in the biography. And
what called?
Oh, God. I don't know.
Okay.
You can find it when you look up Paul van der Velde's website.
Yeah.
Just look for Jacob Hafner and you get to Paul van der Velde's website. And there you can find all his publications. And it has not been translated. It's also not, they found only one or two copies, because he wrote, these people expected somebody to write how fantastic colonialism was, white man's burden, the Europeans were going to save the world with their Christianity and whatever, you know, and he wrote against it. And he proved that it didn't solve anything and that it just created problems and that it enslaved people. And they had not expected that, but there was no other entry, so they had to give him the prize.
Mm.
So he won that prize. And then after that, and after his death, there was a whole bunch of these preachers, these Calvinistic church people, who wrote for colonialism and against Hafner. So, I mean, his voice was, at the time, was completely a voice in the desert.
Mm.
But I mean, now we can look back and we can think, my God, somebody already thought like that, even 200 plus years ago.
Yeah.
You know, he saw it. He saw what was going to happen. He was a visionary in that way.
Yeah.
But he had, in that respect, he had no influence. But he had a lot of influence as a romantic with his stories. And yeah,
that is of interest to us, isn't it? I mean, him as a, you know, if you can call him an anti-colonialist or a pre-colonialist,
yeah,
That is of greater interest. But I think specifically as artists, what really intrigues me is also how he has framed himself through the many romantic stories he's written about his encounters with particularly the dancers here.
Yeah. And the way he describes the dance, you know, I think you will find that I have not posted that because it is part of the biography. And for instance, the story of Mamia, her life story, which is in the, I translated the chapter about dancers, which was before I was requested to make the translation. And that is not so much in the, so that is separate. So that's not in the biography, but the story of her life was that she was the daughter of a YDR, a healer in Tanjore. And then she was as a, an 8 year old or something. She was married to somebody much older, sort of the classical story. And then this man died when she was just 14 and she was treated badly, of course. So she ran away and she came to this group of dancers. Mm-hmm. So Mamia was not a Devadasi. Mamia belonged to these troops of dancers who would roam India for going village to village and perform and make a living that way and make a good living. So
sorry to interrupt you.
Yeah.
You know, because you translated that particular narrative, I'm very intrigued. See, you know, Mamia this is all happening in Tamil Nadu, in Pondicherry.
Yeah, Mamia, mother-in-law. Yeah, I got it. I told the author has no idea. The author has not much, you know, he has not much feeling with India.
Who is this author?
And Paul van der Velde. He and a friend, they re-edited all his books, all the books and some other things are in these, there's three books, but it's all in Dutch. Ah. So you can find most of his works on Internet Archive, also translated in English, except Travels by Palanquin. So one of my projects was to at least sort of take the most, to me, historically most relevant parts. He describes how the post networks were run. He describes the villages. And I've, I don't know, am I going down a rabbit hole or? I traced sort of, you know, I was really planning to translate, let me see, where is my, I was planning to start translating once I was feeling better. No, I need this one and this one. So I took Travels by Palanquin. And of course, the names are all so very different now. But I traced that trip. So he traveled. Okay, he started off in Nagapattinam as a clerk, and then he went to Sadras, and then the war started, and he became a prisoner of war. He fled from Madras, in Madras, and then he fled from Madras to Sri Lanka. He spent some time in Sri Lanka, and he came back to the mainland, and then he spent some time in Calcutta working for one of the hot shots there, the East India Company of the British. Mm-hmm. And the story you can find, this is all from the biography, the English people, that family said that he stole a ship, and he said that he was given a ship. So I mean, this is late 18th century India, so it's a bit, you know. But the story of Travels by Palanquin start in Bimilipatnam, and then he goes to Vishakhapatnam. So he rents a palanquin with carriers, and he has a secretary, a translator. Right. And he travels down, his story is about traveling down the whole coast. And I found all the names, or a lot of the names, back. And then he had to, there were no bridges yet, so he had to cross the big rivers. And let me share an other screen. So I made this. So he started in Bimlipatnam, and sort of I traced the new names as far as possible. And I did the trip once, a couple of years ago. I did the trip. I traveled to Vishakhapatnam. And that time I was traveling with my Dikshita's sons. Mm-hmm. But we did it in 2 days and we didn't see that much. And actually one of my plans is, of course, to go back and to have another good look and maybe write about it, you know, like my relationship with India and his and how it was different 200 years ago. So so the trip is definitely historic. The places he describes, and from every village he tells sort of what kind of village it was and what kind of temple and what kind of produce it had. And so it is, and then he tells about the political situation, like he runs into this bit of East India Company army, marching fast to one of the forts in Andhra Pradesh to topple the king. And that is all historic. So he really was there with his nose on it. And he writes about the dancers and about his relationship with... He writes about his time in
Where do the dancers feature in this autobiography? I mean, at what point does he...
Halfway, two-thirds, he meets Mamiya's troupe in a village and they perform.
Remember which village?
No. No. Okay. I could wait. I could, maybe I can have a... I could find it because
I don't want to trouble you, but just trying to pick your brains. That's all.
No, I mean, with names, stuff like that, it is that is almost impossible. I did it years ago. So no, I mean, I could maybe look it up and send it to you later.
No worries.
But I do feel it is possible that the Mamiya story, as it has been told in the book, is not exactly sort of historical. Mm-hmm. You know, it is because, like he said, he says he meets her in the temple. Mm-hmm. You know, so they meet and they perform. She performs, and then she offers herself to him. You know, as a free woman. Uh-huh. But she's about 16 at the time, so she'd been a dancer for a few years. And then he first refuses her because he wants to respect her. And it's all in the biography. You would have to read Paul van der Velde's book. And then later he is bitten by a snake and he is very worried, and he goes to a local healer, he goes to an English doctor, and it is, you know, it is so interesting because he gives such a good description of the time and about how people were and how they interacted with each other. And he interacted with the Indians. He was not aloof. He enjoyed the company of Indians. He had gone native, yeah, they would say later. And then he meets Mamiya again, and sort of he arrives at the temple and she's just coming out of the pond after her bath. And it's on the front page. Oh, I forgot to bring that book here. Okay, it's on the front page of Paul's book, and because then they're really in love, and then they start a relationship, and she heals him from the snake bite because she had learned from her father, and then they go to Madras, and there they spend some time, like 1.5 years or something like that, mm-hmm. And then he has to do some business. And he's very vague about his business. You know, he doesn't write about what he's actually doing business about, right, except that time to time he spends a longer time in one in Vishakhapatnam and in some of the cities on the coast. And there he does his business, and sometimes he stays 3-4 months. And then, so the whole trip is maybe, yeah, altogether, maybe 2-3 years, you know, out of which a long time is spent in Madras with Mamiya.
So this Mamiya, the name could be very easily, you know, you're also able to understand.
Yeah.
You spend so much time here in India that the name is so non-Indian, definitely non-Tamil, right? I mean,
it is not a personal name. It is not anybody's name. I don't think so. So I don't know why he chose that. He may have had his reasons. I'm quite sure that the details of the relationship, because in the end, I mean, she saves him from drowning as they try to leave Madras. And then, there's a lot of romantic stuff. You know, it could be an Indian movie easily. And in the end, and then sort of soon after, she dies in his arms. And he has her cremated. And then he leaves India because he has nothing to stay for. And I think he always regretted that. But right. I think this is the romantic version.
Yeah.
And I don't think we'll ever find out the actual historic version. And maybe we should not want to.
Yes. No, but I also am then, you know, I mean, since, you know, you've said that, the photographs, I remember you spoke at C.P. Ramaswamy Iyer Foundation.
Yeah, yeah.
And you showed some of the drawings in his,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And the costumes that these women are depicted in.
Yeah.
They're such a, you know, it's an eclectic mix of sort of the Arabic harem pants and.
Yeah, yeah.
What do you think of the costume?
Yeah, I looked in it. I mean, he made drawings, and from those drawings, somebody in Holland made these print sets.
Mm-hmm.
And what was lost in translation, I don't know. On the other hand, some of his drawings, like he has this drawing of Mahabalipuram, and there is this Ganesha stela in front, and that Ganesha stela is exactly there still today.
Mm.
So. You know, I mean, she was not a Devadasi, yeah? She was a free dancer.
Since you say that, I mean, I'm just trying to pick your brain here.
Yeah.
So, you know, in those days, especially in that belt of the Vishakhapatnam, the entire coastal region, they were also dancing women who were non-Hindu, you know. From the Islamic community, the Muslims.
Yeah.
I mean, with her costumes and, you know, sort of if he were accurate in the way he was depicting her visually, is there a possibility that Mamiya was not Hindu after all?
No, because her father was a Vaidya. Well, what is told in the book that is that her father was a Vaidyar in Tanjore.
Right.
A healer, an Ayurvedic healer.
Okay.
So she was not a Muslim, not in the story,
right.
But in reality, probably Jacob had a relationship with God knows how many dancers.
Right.
But he was a lot of the Dutch who were in colonial time or sort of in the 17th and 18th century, they felt closer to the Muslims than to the Hindus because they understood that better, you know, the people of the book stuff. And
right.
So as far as mentality goes, so it was forbidden to participate in Hindu ceremonies. Like that is why finding these two Dutch people depicted on this eclipse pavilion near Mahabalipuram is such an anachronism.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And so fascinating, but I don't think I'll ever go after that either, you know. But I hope, I told historians here, sort of the subject is up. If somebody wants to do an MA on it, it would be a nice subject. Mm-hmm. But have you read, there's two very great historic writings from two Dutch historians. One is Gijs Kruitzer and the other is Leonard Bess. About Leonard Bess has written about the Nayakas.
Yeah. I helped Leonard a little bit for the dissertation.
Okay, right, very good. Now, so you know about it. So, I mean, you can see how these attitudes were, and that for the Dutch people, it was easier to relate to the Muslims than to the Hindus. Mm-hmm. But I don't think everything that Hafner writes about is about Hindus. Mm-hmm. So he had a master, and he also sometimes he was critical. Like for instance, he has this big scene that he visits the temple in Vishakhapatnam at the time of the festival. Mm-hmm. And then he describes how the festival goes on, and he walks the other way and goes and watches the sunrise. And then he writes about, you know, how that is divine and that is a sort of cosmic. So he had this, you know, sort of, and he didn't have it much about, you know, all the rituals and all the goings on and stuff like that.
Right.
But at the same time, he connected to some swamis, like in Sadras and on the way, but he also sometimes was critical about this, you know, that like in his feeling things went too far or were not relevant.
Mm.
But I don't remember him writing much at all, except about Haider Ali and his son, about Tipu Sultan. But that was historical and political.
Right.
And that was not, I don't think on a personal level he interacted much with Islamic people.
Right. On that note, I want to ask you, I mean, in general, what would you say about the presence of the Dutch here? I mean, what has that done to both the culture of the Dutch and the culture here, right? Like over these years.
Yes. No, so we were there for 200 years, yeah? And a lot of what we are today is rooted there. And a lot of things that people here think are sort of really Dutch traditions, I know they came from India. Like all this, we have the St. Nicholas tradition, and we make special biscuits, and it's all with masalas, and we make the marzipan things, and the marzipan that is like the Indian sweets with the almond, right, but then with a little bit egg in it, so you know, so it's slightly different. And I even, you know, when I was a child, we had these small animals and small sculptures of sugar. And when I visited India the first time with my guru in Bangalore in the market, and that was around Christmas and Pongal time, they had the same. They had these big ones in yellow, in pink, these big sugar sculptures that we would eat. And I even think, you know, we have, yeah, there's a big discussion because we have this tradition of black peat, Zwarte Piet. And that is the help of the bishop. And we're a Calvinistic country, you know. We've done away with Catholicism and saints. But we have this tradition of this saint that comes once a year, Saint Nicholas, from Spain. And he has this helper who is black. And I think that goes back to India. They always say it goes back to the Moors. And then they think about North Africa. I think it goes back to the Moors of India.
Right.
And Muslims. Hmm. And we have these gapers, we have these heads, male heads with a turban, with a tongue sticking out, with a pill on it. And they used to be the symbol for a pharmacy.
Hmm.
And everybody thinks also it's Moors, and then they think of North Africa. And they're Indian men, they all have mustaches.
Hmm.
All Indian men. And you know, I mean, I think our time in India shaped us.
Mm-hmm.
Amsterdam was built from the money made.
Mm.
Nobody remembers. We don't remember. We don't take care of it. We don't take care of the graves and the graveyards that are still there. Yes, a little bit. And of course, we have the VOC archives. But who remembers? And then sometimes, you know, somebody has this sort of, oh, we have to go back to the VOC times, to that entrepreneurial spirit. They were all thugs and thieves. Come on, you know? They were all slave traders, and now are there other people who want to tear down those sculptures of these guys? Mm. But there's two sides, because we had this war with Spain between about 1670 and 1640. We had this 80 years war. We financed our independence war with the money made in India and Indonesia. Without that money, there wouldn't be any Netherlands. There wouldn't be any Amsterdam.
Right.
Not that anybody remembers that here nowadays. I mean, they remember Indonesia because in 1947, a lot of people came from there. And we did a lot of abuse there. We behaved very badly. I mean, when people are in power, people will abuse power. I mean, power corrupts. Complete power corrupts completely. And the Dutch are no angels in that respect. So, you know, when people got into positions of power, they misbehave. Mm-hmm. And Jacob Haefner hated that. Mm-hmm. He just hated that. But that was a personal thing. That was a personal choice.
Yeah. Yeah. And on the other hand, I mean, you've also spent a lot of time here in India.
Yeah.
What have we imbibed from the Dutch over these years?
Kakhuis.
Ah, really?
That's a Dutch word.
Wow. Had no idea.
Yeah, it's a Dutch word. Kakhuis means shit room.
Oh, wow.
shit house. Yeah.
Wow, really?
You didn't know? Oh, I thought you would know that one. There are a few other words. I don't know. Some research has been done. You ask Bess and Kreutzer. Those guys will know.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, and of course, yeah, I don't know what else, because, I mean, there were these small settlements. We were not colonialists. We were traders at the time. Eh? Mm. So we did not actually impact. Yeah, I mean, if we had a trade spot, you know, weavers would come, and dyers and stone cutters, and, you know, all kinds of tradespeople would settle. Right. And then if we left, those people would have to move again.
Right.
So there was, yeah, there was a lot of coming and going, and there was a lot of, yeah, there was a lot of illness. This also in Jacob Hafner's story, I mean, you know, he comes to people and somebody is healthy and 3 days later they're dead. You know, it is a, you know, like all these beautiful girls die and friends die, and people died a lot, you know?
Yeah.
We are so spoiled there. People are critical of vaccinations. But I mean, how long ago is it that there were people with polio and smallpox?
Yeah.
Do we want to go back to that time? Do we want smallpox out again and polio? Mm. I mean, I don't understand these people there. Eh? Memory, that sort of the communal memory of humanity is non-existent.
So tell me something. So what, according to you, what remains to be done with Hafner's heritage here? And what are we supposed to do with this legacy, both as Dutch people and Indians and as dancers?
I don't know. I think he's an inspiration. I mean, of course, there are many inspirations. To me, he's an inspiration. I mean, when I read his work, I kind of recognize myself. I sort of, you know, it's like some extent looking in a mirror in a way. Of course, it is a different time. He was a man. He didn't dance himself. And, you know, and yeah.
So he's,
you know, I think his works are an amazing resource for research, historical analysis.
Yeah.
And Travels by Palanquin should be translated sooner or later.
Right.
Yeah, but it's hundreds of pages.
Right.
It's really a big book. And there's so much information in it, you know, about functioning of villages, about, you know, what kind of fish were caught and how people were eating them and what kind of ships people used on the coast. And you know, whenever he does something, he brings in information. He, you know, it's like sort of an article with these, where you have these small frames in which specific information is collected.
Yeah.
So he does that in his books everywhere. And like, I mean, they get drunk on the palm fruit. So he describes that and how it is, how it's fermented, and so, and he in his book about Ceylon, and that is, you know, you go to Internet Archive, I think by now everything that all the different editions or anyway, all the books and also the Dutch books, also Travels by Palanquin, can be found on the Internet Archive. They are also found, we have a database in Holland. Yeah. But yeah, it's in Dutch. Of course, I mean, you can use Google Translate, and yeah, you might miss out on details, but Google Translate between Dutch and English is good enough to get the information,
right,
you know?
Right.
So, he's an amazing resource. I've learned so much from him about that time and about, you know, my whole understanding of the process of how the Europeans came to India, how at that time in 1500 and even still in 1800, India was the most advanced and wealthiest nation on the planet. Mm. 150 years later, what was it?
Yeah.
You know, a backward country that needed aid.
Yeah.
So, I mean, the things the British did, the knowledge that they exterminated, we don't know how wood steel was made. Not really. Not properly, yeah, because they forbid it and they killed everybody who knew. Yeah. And they built this wall around across India to do the salt tax.
Yeah.
I mean, they were so unbelievably cruel. And now they fuss about their sovereignty. I mean, they don't have a right to fuss about their sovereignty. Look what they did.
Yeah.
But it is about dharma and karma and personal responsibility. And yeah, they thought they had the right because it was preached to them from you know, in the churches. Yeah, and now we all somehow the churches lost their power, their grip.
Yeah.
I don't know. Things did change, of course. I'm not sure how that happened. It's quite amazing to see that process.
Yeah.
And the whole process into the colonial situation is also fascinating. And he writes about it and he shines a light on it in a way that nobody else has because he was sympathetic to India.
Mm. Mm.
His heart was on the side of the Indians. And he thought what the British were doing, what the Dutch were doing, what all these greedy people were doing, also within India, because a large part of what happened is, of course, because of greed of individuals, of power hunger of right. individuals. I can't judge that. We can't judge that from our place.
Very true, very true.
Yeah.
No, but also, you know, what do you think, you know, as someone who's a dancer, who's also a researcher, who's also, you know, looking at dance from this, mm-hmm. from its religiosity and the cosmological connection.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right. What does it mean, you know, for someone to travel through a country or travel through different places and record, like, you know, these, I'm just thinking, none of us are recording as much as these people have, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Looking back, I feel like now whatever we're doing, this is a great thing. I wish we had done this for the last 10 years, right?
Yeah. In a sense. Yeah.
I mean, so much. So what do you think is the most important practice that we as travelers and as artists should imbibe?
Sharing. Experiencing and sharing. But yeah, it's also our personal path, of course, towards enlightenment, maybe, supposedly one day. I don't know. Yeah. And connecting. I mean, there is this very interesting book by this Dutch historian who wrote about most people are okay, or I mean in Dutch it's called Meeste mensen deugen, that we advance from collaboration, and that, you know, for the most part when we do collaborate everybody gets better, and it's an important thought to keep.
Right.
To keep in mind.
Yeah. Yeah.
And Hafner, by writing it down, I mean, he wrote it down. He had kept a diary, probably for himself, all his life, all his grown up life.
Yeah.
So he must have been traveling with a chest full of notebooks. And because of money need, he started publishing it. And he did it very well. I mean, he was talented for that. So. But he was forced by necessity. Otherwise, we wouldn't know. We don't know how many people made this kind of trips and didn't share it.
Yes.
And it is about, I think it's about connecting.
Yeah, and I think most often...
Dancing is about connecting. You know, rasa, yato hasta tatu dishti. It's about connecting. It's about taking the audience with you. It's about the dancer connecting to different level of consciousness, to the divine.
Yeah.
And then rasa is created. Rasa, in the end, of course, is the amrita. You know, but behind the, I mean, rasa stands for the amrita. So, yeah, I mean, I think from connecting and from sharing in every way, especially through art, but not only through art, We progress as a species.
That's true, you know. And I keep thinking, just as we speak, of people whose personal diaries have become very strong resources. For example, Anandarangam Pillai.
That's also
diaries. Yeah.
Diarist. Yeah. I read a bit. I wish I had time to read more. He was brilliant, also. Yeah. Very interesting.
Yeah.
About the same time, I think, as Hafner, or a little bit earlier.
A little bit, not earlier, a little bit, little, you know, around half an hour and a little bit later.
Okay. Huh.
So do you want to say anything else about Hafner that we should hear from you?
No, I think, I don't know. No, I think I said all the things that I had planned to say.
Right.
And I think we can stop with this. We can conclude with this idea about that humanity progresses from connecting, mm-hmm. and from collaboration. And I think, you know, the dancers have, I think maybe that is not so much Hafner, that is more my dancer side, you know, the importance of the dancers in India to carry this knowing, whether consciously or not. Mm-hmm. And through the performance in the temples, yes, I mean, all know what has happened. We don't need to repeat that. But when you look at the sculptures, if you look at the sculptures from the Hoysala temples, from the Chola temples, the dancers are everywhere. And you can, from Hafner's descriptions, you can see they were, you know, if, you know, like for instance, Sadras, surrender. British are suddenly, there is a war. It started in Europe. In India, they don't know. The English know just a few weeks before the Dutch. So they come to Sadras and they say, we're at war and you have to surrender. And these people were partying, you know, they were in the middle. Every evening they were getting drunk and partying, yeah. and doing all kinds of naughty things together. And so then Hafner has to organize the surrender. So he has to bring in dancers. Because yeah. he has to welcome the British who are actually coming to take the Dutch prisoner. Mm-hmm. And it is done with the dancers are welcoming the British. And then so the dancers were used in all these social interactions, marriages, anything and everything of any importance that happened, the dancers would be present and they would bring in their rasa and they would bring in that energy and they would make these connections. And the only thing we remember now is temple prostitutes.
True.
And that's you know, that's so beside the point. Mm-hmm. But yeah, that is the colonial attitude. Yeah. And and I know the respect for the dance is still there, but yeah, the Indian people have to reclaim this power, this knowing, mm-hmm. this connection to the divine, yeah. because India still, I mean, everybody has it, of course, even through Christianity, even through Islam. I'm not ruling that out. A personal connection to the divine is possible to anybody and anyone, anytime. But personally, for me, the Sanatana Dharma is an easier road or a more accessible road anyway. Than the others. Oh, this is very political. Sorry. But I mean, we should look at the dance that way, and we should try to overcome all these prejudices that have been put in us the last 150 years,
yeah.
and try to look through them and beyond them and behind them, and look at, yeah, how Hafner describes the dancers.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
With respect and with love. Yeah. And yeah, with respect.
Yeah.
That is the last one in a way. I mean, nobody else after him wrote it down like that. I mean, after that, you get only all those missionaries. Mm. And I don't know. I don't think anybody wrote like that ever. Maybe you know who wrote like that? Mm. Bel de Zoete. Do you know her book, The Other Mind?
Mm-hmm, yeah.
No, you have Hafner and then you have Bel de Zoete. I don't know. There may have been others,
yeah.
possibly. But he had this very personal connection and this very personal love for India, for dance, for dancers. And dancers Beryl's, are...
I think Beryl's very personal, also transformation, right? The way they write about Bala Saraswati, for example, before viewing mm-hmm. performance, and then writing about the same performance after having witnessed it, you know, yeah. the transparency and the truthfulness with which it was written,
yeah,
really mm-hmm. touches you. It really touches you.
Yeah. Yeah, it was one of the first books I read about. It's long ago. I bought it secondhand just recently. I had a photocopy, which has been left with other people. So I bought it secondhand recently, just a few weeks ago. I was so happy when I got it.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, so anyhow.
Lovely.
Lovely.
I'm going to end the recording now, yeah. If it's okay.
Yes. Yeah?